Okay, Rahil, we can see you.
So very good morning.
Look forward to your magic.
Yes, good morning, audience. Sorry, good evening, audience. Good evening, all the senior members, everyone is here. So I'll be demonstrating a near-life procedure of the latest introduction in refractive surgeries, which is the ray tracing LASIK procedure by the name of WaveLight Plus. So just going to share my screen now.
So at the heart of this technology lies this diagnostic device, the InnovEyes Site Map device. Now basically this device is a combination of three technologies: the Hartmann Shack Wavefront Analyser, the PCI Interferometry and Shem Flung Tomography. So now they've made it so simple, so doctor friendly. At a click of a button, all your treatment is ready and planned. You don't even have to do a refraction now. The treatment details, the data is wirelessly transferred to the EX500 machine, and it is now as simple as click and fire. So I want to show you the patient parameters. We are doing left eye WaveLight Plus InnoveEyes on the Alcon EX500 machine. Patient is a 20-year-old male. The subjective refraction is 2.25 spherical with 0.75 cylinder at 180 at 4 millimeter pupil. The calculated refraction by the InnovEyes device is -2.51 sphere with -0.91 at 6, and the corrected with nomogram is 2.51 with 0.82 at 6. We are doing a 100% visual axis offset. The K1, K2 are 42.61 and 42.58. Optical zone 6.5, transition zone 1.25, ablation zone is 9. Corneal thickness of 552, maximum ablation is 53 microns, residual is 379, and flap thickness that we are taking is 120 microns. The flap is made on the Elita Silk machine. So we are ready to start with the procedure now. And you can see these details on the screen. You can see the ablation pattern. I'll show you this pattern in 3D as well. So you can see how the ablation would take place. I'll also show you the higher order abrasion map. So you can just see how we are treating off all the abrasions of the eye, and we are ready to start with the procedure. So speculum on, the flap has already been made. I use the Silk Elita machine to make the flap. The flap thickness is 120 microns. The diameter is about 9.2 because we are working at an ablation zone of 9. So starting off with the procedure, opening the side edge, and of course we have all understood, we all know that the procedure can be done with the flap and without the flap. Both options are now possible. So opening up to the hinge and then opening the full flap, retracting it back and folding upon itself so that the flap is always protected, the inner area is always protected. Now just cleaning the stromal bed. So we want to make sure that there are no residual secretions, any water hydration on the bed, and we are ready to fire. Taking cyclotorsion 2.5 degrees, nice and good. The laser is ready and we start. And you see here that laser is falling onto the stromal bed, doing the ablation. The total ablation that we are doing maximum is 53 microns for this patient. And the ablation is nice and centered with 100% visual axis offset. And now just cleaning the stromal bed, make sure that there are no residuals. A thorough cleaning is essential. Repositing the flap back. The flap is nice and perfect with these newer second generation femtosecond lasers. The quality has really improved, and now flap related complications during the procedure have become zero. So this is really amazing how technology has upgraded. And now light ironing with the Merosil sponge, making sure that the flap is nice and centered in place. and these newer flaps with perfect angles, perfect centration, perfect depth, perfect stromal beds have really improved the outcomes in the modern day refractive procedures. So just waiting for 2 minutes, and then a drop of antibiotic steroid, lubricating gel, and the surgery is complete.
Thank you.
Very nice demonstration, Rahil. Can I ask you a couple of questions about
yes,
the surgery, please? Yeah. What was the size of the flap that you created?
The size of the flap was 9.2.
So 9.2 mm flap, and how about the optical zone that you used for?
Optical zone was 6.5.
What was the pupil size for your patient?
The mesopic was about 5.
Yep.
And we need a minimum of 4.51 for the data to be captured.
Okay.
And the ideal pupil size for data capturing is about 6, and the maximum that can go is about 9.
So does
so what are the data which are captured?
What they are doing is that now they have made it simple. Earlier with Ventura, we had to put in a lot of calculations.
Mm-hmm.
So now they simplified the process. Now they say that it is just a click of a button. And now when you have the data and you have the measurements from the machine, they say that you can kind of verify with the subjective refraction if the data is within plus minus 0.75 of sphere, cylinder or spherical equivalent. Whereas the axial variation that they accept is plus minus 15 degrees.
So what was your subjective refraction in this patient?
That was 2.25 with 0.75 at 180.
And what
we took was 0.63 was ASIK maximum taken, and the sphere was same.
So did you take the readings as it is virgin? What was measured
what was by measured the machine?
Previous studies, the one done in Australia by Dr. Bala, they've shown that if you take the original readings from the machine, there is a 10% overcorrection of cylinders. So now the Alba people have given us a new nomogram that we reduce it by 10%, and that is what we feel like.
Okay.
I believe there's a card that you have to use for this, and certain costs
are possible. Yes, a charging card that you have to purchase extra, and there's got a click fee to it. So it's about 20,000 per eye.
Per eye, no? So in addition, you're talking of for a person, for a patient, 40,000 additional.
Yes, and plus if you include the cost of temporal laser on that, so it costs some
50,000.
So have you compared the contour vision results with this?
What
do you feel the patients feel something different? What do they feel?
Yes, so now we are also looking at comparing one eye Contura, one eye WaveLight Plus. And overall now, what I can say that what data is showing about 120 patients done till now at our center. So all of them were reading 6x6, but about 90% got 6x5 vision, so they could be one line better. And about 40% got about 6x4. And you had two patients that could be 6x3 also.
So, if you look back at your Contura data, which I believe is quite a lot, what don't you think you have similar results with that also?
No.
Contura, we used to get about 7 to 8% patient used to get those 6x5 visions. Most of them were at 6x6 only.
See, how is it different from any of the refractive platforms?
So there are 5 things now which are new in this technology. The first thing is that they have introduced ray tracing for the first time. The second is that now they are not working on a gold standard model. They are working on an individual personalized avatar of the patient. First time we are able to 100% customize. They have introduced automated refraction for the first time. And they are also saying that this technology is future ready. So they say that all those biomechanical changes and epithelial remodeling that happens post-refractive procedure, those are already incorporated. So the vision quality is maintained for a longer duration.
But are they adding any gadget to do the auto refraction, or are we doing this similar workup the way we do it for any refractive machine?
The only addition to the EX500 is the site map device.
So just to for the audience, I'll explain that the first device that was shown by Dr. Chaudhary is InnovEyes, which is a new diagnostic device, which incorporates an auto refractometer just like an AR, along with a Hartmann Shack Wavefront Analyzer, which has been around for a long time in various machines like the Vizx and the NIDEC OPT Scan 2 and 3, as well as in Zioptics. And Alcon also had an analyzer, Wavefront Analyzer in the past, which probably didn't do as well. And now it's come again in a new name, but they have added cheap look capability of the Pentacam, so it gives you the band maps as well. And it's doing a lot of the
PCI also.
Yeah, and a PCI for the axial. So it does give you the axial length as well. So I think it's a fantastic diagnostic device which has come together, and it's doing the planning for you. However, like with any new device, there is going to be its limitations. I remember in 2016 when we first got the Contura Vision upgrade, once that Alcon had the FDA approval, the tolerance limit of going off the nomograms was very little. They wanted you to be within 15 degrees.
Even now here also it's the same.
Yeah, so I think it's going to take some time till we actually are able to experiment with this and get to know, where it works really well. If we know anything from the past, from our experience with Wavefront guided LASIK, whether it was from various other machines, it did well in some eyes and it did lose. It did quite poorly in others.
No, it did well in most eyes.
Yeah. So I guess this is basically an upgrade.
I got the regression measurement went anywhere. Yeah. Because, but then the patients were all happy.
So ma'am,
they were not complaining to us of glare.
So ma'am, patient has come to us for lower order ablation, that is spherical error and cylindrical error. As long as we treat that, 99% of patients are going to be happy.
True. In fact, yeah. Most patients are very happy. The wow factor of this refractive procedure is such that most patients are happy. So, but of course, it's a great idea that it's a, so overall, Rahil, what you done about 1650?
No, but I had gone to that original place where this machine was shown. And they explained beautifully, and lot of operations of the eyes are getting corrected. It's just that in the span of 1 year, and you can become zero. So that's how I've forgotten all of it. But if you go back and talk to them, I only remember coming back very enthralled that how simple they have made it and how it will be useful for little upgraded eyes and all that. So I want the Rajin to
see like an upgrade of the refractive LASIK procedure.
Yes.
We are having to upgrade every
yes.
years, 5 years.
Yeah.
Come up to upgrade that is in fact a very good tool, and in some of the cases that yeah. has worked wonderfully well.
Yes.
So I agree, ma'am. I think even if you look at what has happened in the past with Alcon platforms, they have tried and made sure that the technology has not been overwhelmingly tough. It's been just very, very user intuitive. In a high volume refractive practice, a lot of the work of planning has to be shifted to your technical staff, and it has to be easy. If it's not going to be easy, your patients are not going to have good outcomes, no matter how good the technology, because it's very tough for any ophthalmic surgeon to spend so much time in planning, in a busy practice. So, and Alcon is doing a fantastic job in making sure that the interface is easy.
Would you rate it above the lenticule surgeries?
Definitely, ma'am, because lenticule procedure, the only advantage they offer is the flatness advantage. Otherwise, the quality of vision is comparable to any aspheric LASIK. So, definitely, the vision advantage is there as far as quality and quantity both are concerned.
What I'm saying is, do we have anything promising for this set of patients, like cornea with astigmatism?
No.
It is not going to touch on those patients.
No. I could do the treatment, ma'am, no mixed astigmatism, only.
So, thanks a lot, Rai. Wonderful.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you. Is that all, or do we have one more? Thank you, Rahil. I think that was very well demonstrated surgery, as well as thank you for answering all these questions on this new technology. I think we'll move on to the next.